Ooh, what a morning, huh, everyone? I want to say thank you to Chancellor Swami, to President Meehan, to the Board of Trustees for inviting me back here today for commencement. And I want to say congratulations to all the 2023 graduates. You've worked incredibly hard, and I'm so proud of you, and you should be proud of yourselves and for you and your family. And I'm excited to see what you're going to do in the next chapter of your life. Congratulations. It's been so exciting for me to be back here. Earlier yesterday, I flew in here from Washington, D.C. area, and I was able to have a slice of pizza and Antonio's to go to... It's still good. It's still there, right? It's still there. 30 years later, I went to my dorm JA tower and actually saw my old room, 1704. That was wonderful, and also the Tower Library, which is now obviously the W.E.B. Du Bois Library. I remember many an hour studying in that library, feeling that when it was windy, I could feel that library swaying a little bit. I don't know if the rest of you have ever had that experience before. And also, I was able to go and look at the, which is now Garber Field, which used to be our game field behind the Boyden Building, and just to see my old stomping grounds again, it was wonderful. And also to see so much that has changed here at UMass since I was here. Essentially, this entire building here and this facility and everything over here in the sports complex is all very different than it was when I was here last. It's so exciting to see everything going in the right direction, everything changing, everything growing and expanding, but it's also nice to see all the things that are familiar to me. They are like a warm blanket. I want to talk to you a little bit about my amazing career that started here at UMass. I've been a two-time Olympic gold medalist in 2004 and 1996. Thank you. The first ever women's soccer gold medal in 96, and then also in the World Cup in 1999. Yes, yes. My teammates and I had a fantastic run, and I feel like we really helped launch the beauty and strength of women, women's professional athletes, and giving women a seat at the table of sports and professional, not only that, but also amateur, and just showing the world and this country what women can truly do when they all come together in a like-minded way and to achieve a fantastic goal. So that's been fantastic. One of the things I learned, thank you so much. But I want to go back a little bit more to 1993. And I also want to say to you that this is the first time I've ever been at a commencement ceremony, because 1 year before I was to graduate in 1993, I left UMass to go chase down my dream. I left the school to go chase down my dream to be an Olympian that I had since I was 8 years old. But I want to tell you more about my last game I played here for UMass. We were in the NCAA Final Four down in North Carolina, going up against UNC Tar Heels back when Mia Hamm, does anybody know who Mia Hamm is out there? Soccer people? Back when Mia Hamm was still playing at the University of the North Carolina Tar Heels, and also back then, the women's national team had just recently won the World Cup in 1991 in China. And I always wanted to be an Olympian since I was 8 years old. I made a sign that said the exact same thing about being an Olympian. In 1996, I have a dream. And I knew that for this game against UNC, I would have a fantastic opportunity to show the coach, Anson Dorrance, what I was made of. I felt like our team could actually do the impossible, that we could win against North Carolina, even though North Carolina had won 7 national championships in a row. Out of 7. The beginning, the middle, and the end of all those championships. So we wanted to go down there, and we were thinking we were going to shock the soccer community. So we went down there, and I was excited. I was fired up because Anton Doren was the head coach of the national team at the time, and I figured this is my opportunity. This is my chance to really achieve my dream and play a fantastic game in front of him. Well, if you've ever seen a few different stats on that game in particular, it didn't exactly turn out the way I'd hoped. I got scored on in the first 15 minutes on a penalty kick by Mia, got scored on again, and again, and again. And eventually, we lost that game, and we lost 4-1. And I was absolutely devastated. I went down there with the intention of this game being able to springboard me towards my dream, and it was actually the worst game I had ever played. I'd never given up 4 goals in a single game in my career before. However, what I learned about that game was that success is not a straight line. That is the most important lesson I have ever learned. And I think it's a great lesson for all of you to remember here. And if you remember nothing else from what I say today, please remember success is not a straight line. I remember returning back to campus absolutely devastated. However, a week later, Coach Rudy called me into his office and he said, "Guess what, Bri? I just got off the phone." I said, "I don't know, Coach, what's up?" He goes, "Guess who I was speaking to?" And I had no idea. And he said, "You just got the call up for national team camp." And I was astonished because I said to him, I said, "Coach, what do you mean I got the call up? I just gave up 4 goals in front of Anson." Even though I was literally spinning on my head, making save after save after save, I still wasn't able to win the game. So I don't understand, how could I possibly be going into camp? Coach sat me down and he told me one of the most amazing lessons that I'd ever learned. He said, "Bri," he said, "it's not about a single result. One result does not define you. What defines you is if you get up when you're knocked down. What defines you is if you still forge ahead when all is lost. What defines you is if you keep trying, you keep going, you keep moving towards your goal, no matter what the circumstances, no matter what obstacles come up against you, if you keep having spirit, if you keep having ambition, if you keep resilience and anticipating that what you want will come to you, even if it doesn't come to you in the way you expect, you will be a champion. Your potential, your understanding, your resilience, your passion, your attitude, these are the things that create a champion. Not one game, not one goal, not one job opportunity lost, not one dream that you may not have yet, not one aspiration you thought for sure you would gain by now. Not one setback does not define you. So I went into camp and I was thrilled. I started out number 5 out of 5 on the totem pole and I decided that I was just gonna do my best no matter what because I was gonna control what I could control. And what I could control was my attitude, my work rate, my desire, my ability to learn. I decided to stay within the realm of what I could control and not concern myself with the decisions and the flighting opinions and what other people thought of me. Because when I went into the training camp, I was the only African-American that came in that particular time. And in no time, from November 93 to March of 94, I went from number 5 on the totem pole to number 1. As a starting goalkeeper from the women's national team, the starting goalkeeper of the soon-to-be-named Olympic team that was favored to win the Olympic Games in 1996. And I went forward with that team, and we won, as you all know. And that was a fantastic feat. But I learned a valuable lesson in that 1993 game. I learned a valuable lesson that success is not a straight line. You may have your aspirations and your intentions, but the immortal words of Mike Tyson, everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the face, right? Everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. And the critical time is, what are you gonna do then? What are you gonna do once you get punched in the face? And then I continued to play with the national team, and in 1999, we won the Women's World Cup. And I was flying high. I had won Olympic gold medal in 96, and then a World Cup in 99. And I have to say, I became a success overnight. And something really interesting happened. I took my eye off the prize. I started traveling everywhere. I stopped training as religiously as I was normally doing. I started eating foods I wouldn't normally eat. I wasn't doing my normal routines. I wasn't sleeping like I should. I wasn't training like I should. I wasn't in the mentality that I should be in. And I found myself gaining 25 pounds from July to October. And then when I went into training camp for the 2000 Olympic Games in Sydney, I walked in there 25 pounds overweight, unfit, and completely devastated the coaching staff, and I let my teammates down. And I sat on the bench for that entire 2000 Olympic Games, did not play a single minute. Now think about that for a second. I was as bitter as it could be. And for the longest time, I was looking out the window, pointing fingers at the coach. Why didn't she give me another opportunity? At my teammates, why didn't they battle and fight for me to start? At everybody else. I was pointing outside the window when I should have been looking in the mirror. I self-sabotaged. I was drinking my own Kool-Aid. I was no longer a humble servant of the game, a humble servant of my abilities. I got a little high and mighty, if you will, and I got a little drunk on my own fame. It wasn't until I saw a picture that a reporter had sent me to sign in the mail when I realized what they saw, meaning my teammates and my coach, because I didn't see. I didn't realize how much I had slid. I didn't realize how poorly I had been a steward of my abilities and of my honor and privilege to my team. Once I realized that, I made a change. I changed everything about me. I decided I didn't want to just be the best goalkeeper on the women's national team. I wanted to be the best Briana Scurry I could be. And if it wasn't for that failure, if it wasn't for that self-sabotage, I wouldn't have become the best version of myself in 2004 when I went back to the Olympic Games after losing my father 2 months earlier with a broken heart from him passing away, but an inspired heart as well to have another chance to show what I could do and to play for him, to play for everyone who had supported me all the years, to play for the people who believed in me, to play for my coaches, to play for my family, to play for my father in the Olympic Games in Athens, Greece. And I came there as good as I could possibly be, fit in my mind, fit in my body, focused, centered, determined to show who I truly was. And we won that Olympic Games in 2004, and I played the best soccer I had ever played in my entire life, and we won that thing. And I redeemed myself. And I redeemed myself, and I learned the lesson again. Success is not a straight line. Things don't always go your way. It's a matter of what you do next, what you do with that adversity. A lot of people say when you win, you celebrate and you're proud. When you lose and you fail, you ponder. And when you ponder, you extract the lesson from that failure, from that defeat, from that stumble, from that challenge, and you apply that to yourself going forward. So I did. And then soon after that, I retired, and I was playing club soccer in 2010. It's the last game I ever played. And I came out on a low ball, and I went to scoop it like I had done a million times before. And their attacking forward came in and crashed into the side of my head with her knee. And my life changed. I had a concussion that just would not quit. It would not let me go. It took me down into the abyss. It detached me from who I was. And I became a TBI survivor in that moment. It changed my life. I have not played soccer since. That was April 2010. I had a spiraling of finances. I had a spiraling of fitness. I lived in a single studio apartment in New Jersey. I ended up pawning my gold medals. Pawning my gold medals. Because I was so devastated. I was so depressed and disappointed. And I was in so much pain and so much hurt. And I was reluctant to ask for help. I was reluctant to lean on my teammates because I was so proud and I didn't want to be a burden on them. These same women who worked with me side by side to bring great glory and attention to women, great warriors in the arena of equity and equality, and I didn't trust them enough to ask for help. There was a point where things were very, very dark for me. But I decided to hang in there and just keep going, to do what I could do, to focus on what I could control. And shortly after that, I was thrown a lifeline. I made a decision that I was just gonna keep going. And a few months after that, I got the proper treatment I needed for my concussion. I had an experimental surgery that the doctors and the lawyers wanted me to have on one side, which was my team, but a surgery that the other side, the insurance company, did not think I needed. I finally fought and got that surgery done. I had a wonderful, amazing revelation, a gift come into my life. This woman who came to me and said, I want to help you. And I finally said yes. I finally agreed for help. And I told her every single deep, dark secret, every emotion, everything I had been thinking, all the doom and gloom of what I was feeling. And she said, I'm going to help you. She did exactly that. And got the insurance company to do the right thing. I had the surgery, I had a year of therapy after that, and 5 years ago today, I married her. My wife, Chris Azizos. She's back there, by the way, in the blue jacket on the railing back there. I love you, honey. I love you. And now I have an amazing family. I have a fantastic career. I go around the country speaking to different corporations about diversity, equity, inclusion, about overcoming obstacles, about leadership. And it all stems back to this place. All of you here, please, every single one of you has greatness within you. Every single one of you has dreams and goals and desires. Every single one of you is capable of changing the world in whatever it is you're doing. It has nothing to do with Olympic gold medals and soccer and sports or anything else. It has nothing to do with being famous. It has everything to do with what is in your heart, what you have passion about, what you dream about, what you aspire to. It was put inside of you for a reason. And there's going to be obstacles. There's going to be storms on the horizon. There's going to be job opportunities that don't go well. There's going to be difficult people to work for and to work with. But I guarantee you, every single one of you here has now the tools from this amazing university to do exactly that, to change the world in your own little way. Can you imagine how the world will change if every single one of us in this stadium today does our little bit to do that? If a young, skinny, little black girl from a 2,000-person community in Minnesota can come to UMass and then go on to win Olympic gold medals and World Cup championships, what can you all do? Imagine that. Imagine what you can do, and it'll be so. Congratulations, graduates. Thank you. You are all amazing. Thank you.